What brings me awe? I mean, it's a cliche as an astrophysicist to say that what brings me awe is staring at the night sky, but it is, right? Like, it, even after, you know, sort of over 12 years of, like, university education and stuff, you know, like, being in university for that long, like, it's still, like, even understanding it to some minor degree brings me awe to stare at the sky and think of the scale of it. And just the sheer size and the sheer number of things in the universe when we look at them. You know, with our eyes, we can see maybe 3,500 to, like, 4,000 stars on a really dark night with no moon, with no light pollution. And that is not even a scratch in terms of, like, the amount of stuff that's in the universe. And I know a lot of people get this sort of feeling of, like, helplessness when they look at the sky because they feel so insignificant compared to the sheer size and the sheer scale of the universe. But I have this sort of opposite feeling. Like, I don't get anxious in that sort of helpless way. I feel like there's infinite possibilities, you know, and there's infinite things that I could do, and there's infinite things that where I could go and to be, and that, like, gives me hope more than anything. And hope and awe, I guess, is what it gives me. So
I think what brings me a lot of awe in my day-to-day is when I see massive physical scales of engineering. When I see, you know, when I get to get up close to a rocket engine, get up close to a launch pad, get up and see how the tiny, insignificant little people are walking around it, working on these huge scale endeavors, and just there's something to me about that not only brings, like, an awe of, like, just like, what? You know, like, that kind of shock, but also in this, like, next level of, like, look at people working on something much bigger than themselves. I think my scale of awe has shifted. I used to be big, you know, growing up, I always loved hiking and mountains and things like that. And those will still bring me a sense of awe and grandeur, you know. But, like, at the same time, I don't know, there's something almost as equally significant about people doing something that's just physically impossible. Just, you know, centuries prior. So Starlink is going to be one of the first low latency, high bandwidth global internet constellation. So basically being able to have internet quite literally anywhere around the world.
I mean, the first time I heard about Starlink, I think I remember thinking, that's a great idea, broadband for everyone, you know, like, that can't be a bad thing.
The goal or the plan is to launch eventually over 40,000 satellites.
And then slowly realize what it actually meant for astronomy to have that many satellites as they're proposing up there.
They do these by launching them currently at 60 at a time on a rocket.
On your screen, we see the Starlink satellites have deployed.
Satellites that are currently in orbit around the Earth is just shy of about 5,000. So we're already in the realm where the number of satellites we have orbiting the Earth outnumbers the number of stars that we can see on the best night. Starlink and other, you know, these big, like, constellations of satellites that they call them from sort of Amazon and OneWeb, if they all get their way, it'll at least triple the number of satellites in the night sky.
That's kind of the groundbreaking thing, is that it's forming this mesh network that the more there are up there, the greater the bandwidth, the greater the connectivity is.
When city light erased the night sky, astronomy went rural. But with satellites now flooding the night sky, is this the end of astronomy?
Since antiquity, there's been a scale for measuring the brightness of stars, invented by that guy, Hipparchus of Nicaea. The idea was the first stars that come out at night, call those the magnitude 1 stars. And then you wait, you know, a little while, 15 minutes maybe, and you start seeing more stars. Those are the magnitude 2 stars. By about magnitude 6 or 7 or 8, that's where the human eye can't see them anymore. The initial Starlink satellites that were launched were about magnitude 2 or 3, so really visible to the naked eye.
The reason that these satellites were so bright to begin with was because they were super close to the Earth in order to increase the speed of the internet connection down to the ground. Improvements made by SpaceX to address these astronomical concerns have brought their magnitudes down to somewhere between 6 and 8, dim enough to be almost indistinguishable to the naked eye. But if you start taking long exposure photographs of the night sky, you allow more light into your camera sensor, let's say 30 seconds of light. This is where you start to run into issues.
The magnitudes of the objects that I look at are magnitude 17, 18. So we're still definitely gonna be able to spot them.
That means that the Starlink satellites are roughly 10,000 times brighter than the galaxies that Dr. Becky studies, and something like 100,000 times brighter than the near-Earth asteroids that we can detect.
And it's particularly a big issue because the Starlink satellites are most visible at sort of before sunrise and sunset. They're still in sunlight and they're not in Earth's shadow, but you are in Earth's shadow, so you are at nighttime at that point. And that's also the time that we can really easily spot near-Earth asteroids as well. So it's kind of like, do you want us to continue to look for near-Earth asteroids?
Most asteroids large enough to cause global extinction are discovered and aren't predicted to hit Earth in the next 100 years. But there are still dim and distant comets we don't know about, and undiscovered city killer asteroids in our own orbital neighborhood.
When this telescope comes online, we're gonna get a bajillion images, like every night. It looks cloudy, but just pretend every night. And we need to find new interesting things that have changed in the images. So if a supernova goes off or an asteroid moves across the image, we need to have a halfway reliable reference image that we can compare the new image to say, okay, did something interesting and real change between these two things? And if so, send an alert out.
To catch an asteroid, all you have to do is take about 3 or 4 pictures of the same part of the sky. Then you compare those pictures. If you see something moving through the images, there's a good chance that it's an asteroid. And if it is, you can get a good guess of where it'll be in a couple months and a rough guess of whether it'll hit Earth in the next 100 years.
If one of those 3 or 4 observations is photobombed with a satellite streak, you can't get the orbit of that asteroid. And like, you can't go back and do it later because who knows where it is.
The worst case is the summer when the nights are the shortest, so you can actually see the satellites all night long. But in the best case, in the winter, you only catch them for a portion of the night, before sunrise and after sunset. But there's another breed of mega telescope. One that sees colors that our eyes can't. And because of that, can operate 24 hours a day.
how did the universe begin? You know, the biggest sort of smoking gun piece of evidence we have is from radio telescopes detecting the echo from the Big Bang. The image of the black hole that was taken in 2019, the first image of a black hole from the Event Horizon Telescope collaboration, that was this connection of radio telescopes all across the world to make essentially a continent-sized telescope. That was all through radio waves.
Is there life beyond Earth? One of our best hopes to finding out is, again, with radio telescopes, looking for precursor molecules to the emergence of life in the radio frequencies between 10 and 15 gigahertz. Not to mention listening for radio signals saying, hello, or may we colonize your planet, please, coming from other star systems.
And you can imagine the interference from 40,000 satellites all communicating together down to people on Earth.
Even though radio frequencies are carefully divided for different uses, radio transmitters are far from perfect, with distortion and harmonics and other interferences bleeding into the wrong frequencies. A growing cacophony, and satellites only make it harder to filter signals and noise. As the astronomers try to listen to whispers from long ago. Space, the final frontier, is kind of like the Wild West right now. There's no regulations that hold back anybody from launching tens of thousands of satellites. I mean, you have to get FCC approval in order to launch a satellite for the radio frequencies so that you don't step on communication channels used by the military and radio, etc. But there's nothing to say that I could go launch 10,000 satellites and they could totally ruin astronomy. As Starlink connects the world, the ultimate goal is to get humans to the red planet, paving the technological path beyond our cosmic isolation on Earth. It turns out that sending NASA astronauts to the space station, sending commercial satellites to geosynchronous and low Earth orbit, and reusing their rockets like that one, which was the first one to successfully land ever, it doesn't make enough money to get humanity to Mars. But how about providing infrastructure for a global internet, paving the financial future to Mars by providing internet to the 50% of the world that remains disconnected?
You have communities in the United States who do not have internet. And our reservation is just south of the Hoh River. It runs along our north border. The nearest Walmart is an hour and a half either direction. The nearest somewhat decent mall is probably about 2.5 hours, maybe 3. We've been trying to get internet down to the reservation for quite some time, and it was like, you know, do we have the right permits? Can we go through these certain properties? Can we dig here? Can we, you know, we still don't have fiber to the reservation. I mean, we're literally like a bump above dial-up. 0.3 megabytes to 0.7 megabytes. So it's like very, very slow. If they were to rent a movie, they would start downloading like on Tuesday or Wednesday, and it would be ready by Friday so they can have it for the weekend, you know? So when the pandemic, you know, hit, the school sent, you know, all the kids home. Doing this Zoom, you know, out on the reservation was not even possible. I mean, it'd be very pixelated, cutting out, and maybe even dropping off.
As the 2020 pandemic rolled on from weeks into months, in June, SpaceX launched their 500th Starlink satellite and began rolling out their beta program. At this point, the Hoh Tribe got in contact with SpaceX.
When we set up the first one down there in Hoh River, I was so excited. I quickly looked through my, you know, what's the longest movie I can find right now, and it's actually Jurassic Park. And the whole movie downloaded in probably about maybe 90 seconds. A lot of the kids, like as soon as it was up, right away, some of them weren't even, you know, shy about it, of like, can I get YouTube then? It's like, yeah, you can get YouTube. If we had any special needs students with the internet, it opens up an opportunity for them to have a lot more access to maybe a different person who has a different teaching style.
in overly developed nations like ours, we tend to be like, well, so what? The people of, rural Asia, they don't have YouTube? Oh, sorry, they're worrying about other things. Like, that tends to be like, they're trying to feed their family and we're trying to give them YouTube. Excuse me, like, first off, who are you to trivialize their problems, right? But like, also, when people solve their own problems and have access to knowledge and information, they change their own lives, they change their region's lives, and make an impact.
Just being able to learn something, you know, and not have to go, you know, 3 hours, 4 hours away, you know, just to learn something. I mean, we have a library down on the reservation, but even right now, that's even closed.
I remember asking my parents why Beetlejuice was red. My parents didn't know, and I remember being like, well, I gotta go find out. You know, this was sort of pre-internet days. I was maybe like 8 years old, so I was like running to the library at like the next chance I got, right, to try and find out like why Beetlejuice was red.
Beetlejuice is red because it burns cooler than most stars. And it's a supergiant star, over 700 times the size of the sun. It's 548 light years away, plus or minus 90 light years. And it's likely to explode in the next 100,000 years or so. And when it suddenly dimmed last year, everybody got really excited, wondering if it would explode early. It turns out that it was probably just dust floating in front of the image. We know these things because of astronomers chasing their curiosities wherever they'll lead, and accidentally finding out things about our own sun, when it might blow, and what to do if it gets angry. We've been doing this for centuries, writing things down and passing them on. Once upon a time in great libraries, nowadays on great websites.
But what does our future understanding of the universe look like if half the sky is unobservable for half of the year?
The thing I'm most excited about for LSST is the weird things it's going to find that we don't know to expect. It's going to find things that change, and we don't fully understand what we'll find, which is super great. I just really fear that the reverse of that, you know, we won't ever be able to find things that we otherwise could have because we decided that it was more important to have a world with 100,000 satellites.
It makes me wonder, like, collectively, if we look 50 years in the future, which will be better for humanity? Giving access to of internet to people that currently literally don't have internet right now, or continuing the same level of, you know, ground-based observations that we have today? Because part of me thinks a lot of ground-based observations will become obsolete in the next 10, 20 years anyway, with much greater access to space-based observations, much better. And there's even been talk about Starlink themselves being a bus for optical observations, being able to form, you know, optical arrays that can literally cover the globe and point outwards and be a way better service to the, you know, astronomy community than anything on the ground.
Like, one of the things Elon Musk did, I remember when everybody started freaking out, was like, well, this is just more reason that we should put more space telescopes up. And like, okay.
You're going to pay for that? The amount of space telescopes you would have to put up there is, it would just be ridiculous, right? And it would be so, so expensive.
The Hubble Space Telescope took about $5 billion to launch into space. And the James Webb Space Telescope cost about $10 billion, and it hasn't even been launched yet. Whereas the Very Large Telescope cost about $400 million, and that's four telescopes all in one. So it's a pretty slippery slope to just say that you can just launch space telescopes.
I feel like there has to be some kind of way for it to not be a total lose-lose. And I don't think it's going to be a total win-win, I'll be honest, but people who say it's one or the other lack creativity. But I don't have a magical solution to propose.
So there's this awkward overlap where, yeah, we don't have like the perfect solution for some of those problems, but at the same time, the potential for these things, in my opinion, I would gladly be skewed otherwise, but from my opinion, the potential for good is substantially higher than the potential for harm.
We stand at a crossroads, but it's not between astronomy and Starlink, as it might seem. It's actually much, much bigger than that. See, the solutions are actually pretty simple. Just keep the satellite constellations small. Keep their orbits as close to the Earth as possible so they stay in Earth's shadow for much longer. Keep them dark, like magnitude 8 or darker, and point them away from radio telescopes when they're flying overhead. These are trade-offs the companies will have to make, capability that they'll have to give up. But this isn't the crossroads that we have to face either. You know, some argue that Starlink is just classic profit motive exploitation, and it's masquerading in the armor of that greater good argument. Meanwhile, others say that these astronomers are just caught up in their own first world problems, unable to see a hopeful future in front of them. These are symptoms, I think. They're not the real decision that we have to make. When the light bulb was invented, inventors were after the goal for progress and the excitement and the profit as well. They weren't trying to erase the night sky. But here we are 100 years later, and entire generations, including myself, have grown up missing something that every human being held a personal connection to for a million years, a connection which stimulated the modern age of science and technology. What if we could start to see space and the night sky and the planets from Mercury to Neptune as part of our heritage, as something which in its exploration, not its exploitation, we learn more about what it means to be alive and what it means to be human. Like the constellations before satellite constellations, what if space could guide the way for the next era of human discovery? That's the decision that awaits us, whether or not we choose to see the space and the people in the world around us, not as resources ripe for extraction, but as miracles awaiting revelation. And the fact that we share one blue sky, one terra firma, one area code in the cosmic expanse gives me hope. As the sun rises and the last star dims away in the sky, and the memories of the night come flooding into my brain, and I'm like, was that real? I'm faced with the recognition of how different it is being in a city than seeing the night sky here. I think losing the night is transforming us. I think losing the night is probably not the worst thing that we're doing to ecosystems and our environment and our human experience. But there's something I hope we don't lose. I mean, when I come out here to see a dark night, I come out often because I feel a little bit confused. I feel a bit alone. I feel lost in the mess of it. And coming out here connects me with a deep piece of what it means to be human, I think. To wonder. Here we are. Why? Thank you. I mean, when... Never mind.